decision on.
Good morning and welcome to Palmetto Presbyterian Church. We're really glad you're here. Okay, here's the first announcement question. What is Tuesday, February the 28th? Tuesday, February the 28th. Who said my birthday? Is it really? Oh, he's always going to do that. Well, Tuesday the 28th is the day the IRS comes to town. Yes, the inventory reduction sale is coming. Volunteers have been getting the thrift store reorganized last week and on Saturday. It looks great. At one point, there were so many volunteers in there, if everybody had bought something, we wouldn't be having this inventory reduction sale. But on Tuesday, everything will be one half off. Come all, one, come all, it'll be terrific. Okay. On Monday, the 27th, the spiritual journey continues. The women of the church and beyond, a number of visitors, will be discussing two steps forward. The author's name is Sharon Brown. Once again, what happens on February the 28th? That's right, the inventory reduction sale. Oh, that's right, Brian's birthday. Are there other announcements? Serious, unserious, whatever. Choir announcements?
Some of them might know Mary Jane Smith, who died yesterday.
Thank you.
Steve Smith's wife.
Steve Smith's wife, Mary Jane Smith, died yesterday. And I do not know the gentleman's name, but a Mr. Nyhus. Oh, gosh. Sorry. I'll look that up. No other announcements? Well, I always feel like this is superfluous, but stand up, greet your neighbors, tell them to come over and get some of those tomatoes that keep growing in this winter time. Oh. I didn't know the man's name, Mr. Nyhus.
Nyhus.
2 weeks ago.
Norm, you're talking about Norm.
Steve told me about his job.
Norm Mayhouse. We call him Mayhouse. I know him.
What time, Annie, will the store open on IRS Day?
That's why she stays longer than her family. In fact, they're coming to visit today.
Good morning, all you lovely ladies. Good morning. Good morning, Miss Kathy. Good morning.
I'll be getting ready to sing a couple. So when you got practice, you won't be singing anything.
Good morning.
Good morning.
He's home. He did not sleep a wink last night.
Well, I wish they were still here.
At the pet scan.
And it abbreviated them. And the weather's changed.
Oh, well.
Unless the weather changed.
Unless we get a call that says, you know, the insurance agent.
Okay. The IRS starts on Tuesday at 12 o'clock. The man's name I was trying to remember is Norm Nehouse. Nyhouse. And guess whose birthday it is today? Not Brian's, but Jim Rohrbacher's. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Jim. Happy birthday to you. As forgiven people, let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts. May the peace of Christ be with you all.
Thank you.
Welcome to worship. We come to worship God. First, with our prayer of confession, let us pray together. Lord, you know how often we are tempted. We want to grab the gusto. We want to be number one. We find it easy to give in to temptation, to overindulge, to overdo, to feel bad in the morning, or guilty at 2 a.m. Please save us from temptation and forgive us our sins. We know that yours is the kingdom, the power, the glory. Give us strength to stand fast against the powers that would undo us. Let us remember that Jesus was tempted by the devil without giving in. Give us the power to realize truth from falsehood. Forgive us our sins. Let us assure each other of our pardon. Know that God can forgive sinners. Know that God has forgiven you. You are restored to life. Share that life. Our hymn of celebration this morning is Just As I Am, hymn number 488. Let it, as we sing. Let us affirm our identity in Christ using the words of Matthew 23, Jesus' response when the Pharisee asked, what is the greatest commandment? Let us say together. Our Lord Jesus said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the greatest and first commandment, and a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Amen. Please be seated. On Wednesday evening, Ash Wednesday, we introduced the question, where does your worth come from? A gigantic question. Where does your worth come from? At one book club, we've been reading a book called Do I Stay Christian? A Guide for the Doubters, the Disappointed, and the Disillusioned. The first part of that book gives reasons why one might reject Christianity. And some of those reasons are pretty compelling. We have a history of being anti-Semitic. We have many immoral forms of violence, such as wars of aggression, witch hunts, child abuse, and you could name the rest. We also have colonialism and patriarchy. As a matter of fact, those reasons make for pretty provocative reading during the beginning of Lent, a time devoted to confession and repentance. Today is the first Sunday in Lent. In the gospel reading for today, Jesus is going into the wild, into the wilderness. It deals with temptations that we know well. More on that later. For the moment, let's think about the reasons why Jesus might have gone into the wilderness for 40 days right after he was baptized. Remember when John baptized Jesus, a dove descended and a voice said, "This is my beloved Son. With him I am well pleased." Seems strange to me that rather than capitalizing on that sort of miraculous anointing, that Jesus would go into the wilderness for 40 days, a wild place. 40 is a number that resonates with key aspects of Jesus's hearers, of Israel's experience. When we hear that number that Jesus went into the wilderness for 40 days, maybe we remember that it was 40 days that Noah was in the ark before it came to rest. Moses' encounter with God and inscribing the Ten Commandments took him 40 days. The children of Israel wandered 40 days into the wilderness. So, those were times of preparation, and presumably that's what Jesus was doing, preparing. That's when his public ministry began. So, Matthew wants us to hear that 40, 40, 40, that inscribing, that's basically saying, this is the one that I have enlisted. This is the son of Israel that I've been talking about and that Israel has experienced. 40 is also the number of days, excluding Sundays, in Lent. Why Sundays are excluded is anybody's guess. As Christians aim to participate in Jesus' ministry and follow his way toward the cross, this is Lent, a time of preparation for us. We're called to think about how we might best prepare ourselves for the way that God has for us to live in the places where we are. To what mission is God calling us? What might be needed for our congregation, corporately and individually, to be prepared? Hear the word of God as it is found in Matthew chapter 4, reading verses 1 through 11. The word of God. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. He fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and afterwards he was famished. The tempter came to him and said, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become bread." But he answered, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." God. Then the devil took him to the holy city and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you're the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their heads they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone." Jesus said to him, "Again, it is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. And he said to him, "All these I will give you if you will fall down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him." Then the devil left him, and suddenly angels came and waited on him. This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. In part two of the book, the author Brian McLaren gives the reader several reasons to remain Christian, but they're pretty pragmatic. He does not mention the great contributions of the church through the ages, such as the building of hospitals, schools, and great libraries, the church's support for music and the arts, and Christianity's call for universal literacy so that everyone could read. He does not mention the work of the church in underdeveloped sections of the world, medical, dental, and educational missions that are dear to my heart because my dad was one of those medical missionaries in the Republic, what's now the Democratic Republic of Congo. McLaren's reasons do not include the love for each other and of everyone that God made incarnate in Jesus the Christ. Well, as a matter of fact, some members of the book club thought that the reasons for leaving the church were more compelling than those the author provides for staying. And the truth of the matter is that over the centuries, Christians, the church, have done horrible things in the name of God. And some people are tempted to turn their backs on Jesus Christ precisely because of that history. More and more people give in to the temptation to leave the church. After all, Reformation seems futile. Every other week, a new scandal emerges in the church somewhere, and COVID reminds us of just how comfortable it can be to stay in bed, keep on our pajamas, have a second cup of coffee, read the newspaper. There really is a lot of work that needs to be done in the church. We need to be careful. So the temptation may be a part of your wilderness experience. So it's sometimes part of mine. Another reason Jesus went into the wilderness was so that it could be shown that he was in fact the Messiah. He was tempted in all ways, even as we are, yet without sin. The devil tempted him to give up the genuine source of his authority, to grab for the cultural forms of power and pleasure instead, to become a selfish leader, to forget his true identity, to forget whom he trusted, to forget where his worth came from. We're tempted in much the same way. The first temptation was an appeal to Jesus's hunger. Scripture has that verse that said Jesus was famished. Why don't you turn these stones into cinnamon buns, you know? Or better, you know, long johns with custard filling and chocolate on the on top of them. Or whatever your favorite temptation is. You know how good they are. And you can feel the saliva developing, right? Notice that the devil is tempting Jesus to employ his personal miraculous powers for his own comfort. Turning the stones into bread is something that Jesus might do to satisfy his own hunger. I think it's helpful to note that by accepting the devil's promises, Jesus becomes disloyal to Yahweh. He would, in effect, be worshiping the devil. The second temptation takes us to the temple. And scripture says that the devil takes him to a high place in the temple and suggests that Jesus throw himself off that place so that the angels can come and grab him and protect him. The angels will take care of you. They won't let anything happen to you. All these people will see your power, and they will bring their personal acclaim. Again, the temptation is to gain personal acclaim and fame. Notice, if you will, that Jesus never performs a miracle for his own sake. It's always for the sake of the person who's being healed, or for the sake of the crowd, as in the 5 loaves and 2 fishes. Third temptation is a political one. The devil shows Jesus the splendor of all the kingdoms of the world and says, I'll give you all of these if you only fall down and worship me. Wow. How do I bring that home? You ever pass those signs that say $1 billion is in the jackpot at Mega Millions this week? You know, imagine that being the same as the devil offering Jesus power over the whole world. This strikes at the heart of Jesus's ministry, because he is the man for others, not just for himself. His ministry is to the common good of all the cosmos. And I think that Jesus is particularly vehement in rejecting this third temptation. Get away from me, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve. Whom do you trust? Whom do you trust in this season of Lent? Is it our private comfort? Is it individual power? Is it personal, economic, or political advantage? Private comforts, individual fame, and imperial forms of power are not worthy of our trust. They will fail us sooner rather than later. We're not complete in and of ourselves. That lack is a permanent part of our condition. We have an emptiness, a lack, which all manner of desires can promise to fill up. And many, many times our desires lead us to want to fill ourselves up, I believe. If only such and such would happen, if only we had more money, if only, that expresses a basic restlessness. But after seeking all those things, after sacrificing for those things, and laboring and obtaining those things even, we find we still have a God-shaped hole, as Blaise Pascal said. To be Christian does not close that hole. Rather, we come closer to closing it when we accept that we're finally created for relationship with God and with each other. Perhaps the goal of the life of faith isn't to escape our human limitation, but to discover God amid our needs and learn with Paul that God's grace is sufficient. Wow. I'd like to think over the next Sundays in Lent about what trust means. I think that's somewhat difficult, but I think that that would be helpful for me anyway. Now, I'd love to know which of those temptations that Jesus had was most alluring to him. What made him hesitate just a second before rejecting them? As for myself, I sort of like the cinnamon bun rolls and donuts. So other fleshly pleasures would probably get me. What bedevils you? Listen to that word. What bedevils you? Which of those temptations or other temptations get to you? Jesus knew those struggles, and we survive and flourish only as he did, by finding hope and courage in God. This is the same God who named him and all of us beloved children. We discover who we are by recalling whose we are. Back to Brian McKellen's book for a moment. Much might tempt us away from the Christian faith, and many have followed those false paths. The church has done monstrous things in the name of God. We believers are still guilty of many heinous sins like racism, sexism, ageism, and others. But the question that guides McLaren's book is the same question we face. How do you want to spend your one precious life? Whom do we trust? Let us pray. Almighty God, we recognize ourselves in these temptations. We study them in order both to know that Jesus faced them the same way we do, but also to know that he resisted. Help us see through the falseness of these temptations. Help us to learn how to be and how to worship only you. For we pray in Christ's name. Amen. We receive our morning offering as our response to God's love, God's concern for us. I'll pray loudly. Hallelujah. You know that just because we do not pray for the particular person or concern that you have, that does not preclude you from praying for them. So let's pray. Almighty God, giver of life, strong spirit of resistance, give us the wisdom to know when and how we are tempted. Put in us the spirit that was in Jesus Christ, who, tempted as we are, had the fortitude to resist evil and to continue to reflect your goodness. Help us to act with simple goodness, always disposed towards others, and being aware of the need for self-care. Remind us, especially during Lent, that Jesus had to go apart and spend time with you on retreat, that to find time to pray and worship you is important. Give us the sensitivity to know when neighbors are hurting. Make us those who can be counted on to feed the hungry and clothe the ragged. Thank you for the many volunteers who are working in the thrift store, and for the mission that you have given Palmetto Presbyterian Church. Bless us, we pray. For those who suffer hardships during the winter months, and we're alert to Turkey, Syria, Ukraine, and many in our own cities. Comfort those who are grieving, particularly the families of Cliff and of Mary Kay Smith, and others. We pray also for those who are ill, for Mo, Ruth, Corey, Dean, Diane, Steve, Donna, Fred, we thank you for Dory's passing her exams, for Nancy's getting better, for all those who are recovering. Make us grateful for the joys that we experience. Please give us perseverance to continuing following Christ. Help us to know that you are the way, the truth, and the light. For we pray in the name of him who taught us how to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive our debtors. But deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 634, More Love to Thee. Let us stand as we sing. Thank you. Please remain standing as we bless each other using the benediction found in your bulletin. We go nowhere by accident. Wherever we are, God is sending us. Wherever we are, God has put us there. God has a purpose in our being there. Christ, who dwells within us, has something he wants us to do through us, where we are. Believe this and go in the joy of God's power and love and grace. Please be seated.